Good morning. Good morning, everyone. Good morning and welcome to the 5th Cuyahoga County Conference on Social Welfare. My name is Victoria Marion, and I am the co-chair this year. It is a plum-pleasing pleasure and humbling honor to stand here today. I remember when a few of us, as members of the Region 3 of the NASW Ohio chapter, sat at Artifino's with Professor Dover, talking about having a conference. I did not want it. So let me say right now, thank you, thank you, thank you, Dr. Dover. The tables are gone, and the reason the tables are gone is because there are so many of you that are here again, or here for the first time. And so today I hope that you will learn something new, share something that you've learned with someone else, network, and enjoy. And so right now I will introduce Julian Rogers, who will introduce our speaker. He is the Director of Community Partnerships.
Good morning. Again, my name is Julian Rogers. I'm the Director of Community Partnerships for Cleveland State University, and I'd like to welcome you all here today to the 5th Annual Cuyahoga County Social Justice Conference. This is a great crowd, like last year, and I see that the conference is growing and more people are attending, so I'm really looking forward to what's going to happen today, all the exciting news you're going to hear, and hopefully a lot of great ideas will come out of what is said here today. I have the great and distinct honor of being charged to introduce our keynote speaker, Mr. John Corlett. I've known John for many years, and as a community, we are extremely lucky to have someone with his expertise serving our community. John has spent nearly 30 years advocating on behalf of issues important to families and children, women, and persons with disabilities and other vulnerable populations. He currently serves as president and executive director of the Center for Community Solutions, a nonpartisan think tank focused on solutions to health, social, and economic issues. Prior to this, John served as the vice president for government relations and community affairs for the Metro Health System. The Metro Health System is the largest, most comprehensive healthcare provider in Northeast Ohio, serving the medical needs of Greater Cleveland for almost 170 years. Before joining Metro Health, John served as the Medicaid director for the state of Ohio, where he was successful in expanding Medicaid for more Ohioans, and his career has come full circle as he once served as a senior fellow with the organization he currently runs. He's held key posts with the Center for Families and Children, Planned Parenthood, the Westside Community Health Center, and his accomplishments have resulted in a number of awards, including being named Child Advocate of the Year, the Public Children's Service of the from the Public Children's Services Association of Ohio, awards from Planned Parenthood, Friend of Public Education from the Ohio Federation of Teachers, a Leadership Award from the Human Rights Campaign Fund, and Advocate of the Year from the Ohio Association of Area Agencies on Aging. Without any further ado, I'd like to introduce and bring up to the stage my friend, John Corlett.
Good morning, everybody. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. Julian, thanks for that kind introduction. I really appreciate that. You know, Cleveland State's fortunate to have you here at Cleveland State on this looking at how to foster partnerships between a great university like Cleveland State and the community at large. I mean, I think that's really important right now. I mean, we're dealing with a lot of really serious issues in this community, whether it's violence or poverty or racism. It's time to sort of think about how we can expand those partnerships and work together to address some of those issues. I also want to recognize Michael Dover from Cleveland State University School of Social Work for his efforts, tireless efforts. I don't know how many of you got emails from him at least twice a day, every day of the week or something. So he is and usually in the middle of the night. I would get those when I woke up in the morning. So thank you for your efforts to organize this.
Thank you, John, and I think we need to turn your
mic up?
Volume up.
Okay.
Is there a sign here? Okay, well, I'll send somebody.
I will speak more directly into the microphone. And then I also want to recognize Victoria Marion Elaine Jackson, who serves as the conference co-chairs for this event. There's a lot of great workshops that are arranged for you today. It'll be hard for us to choose what we want to go to, but I think all of them look really interesting. And I also want to recognize some of my colleagues that are here that are doing workshops today. Rose Freck, Emily Campbell, and Callie Mersman are also doing workshops today from the Center for Community Solutions. You know, It's an honor to be here, and Julian talked about some of the kind of work that I've done over the years. I recognize a lot of you from folks that I've worked with at different agencies here in Cleveland. And, someone asked me earlier if I was a social worker, and I said, I probably should have been, because you're kind of my people. You're the folks who I sort of relate to. You're the folks who do the work that I think is really important. In my experience, social workers do this thing where they are able to bridge between practice and policy, that they sort of work on the front lines. They're the ones who, take that abused child in the middle of the night to the emergency department when they take him into custody. They're the ones who investigate elder abuse. They're the ones who connect you with food stamps and with TANF assistance and get you your child support and do all those things that help people and help people become more independent. So you're my people, and I'm glad to be here with you here today. And I've also, I've been involved with Community Solutions, and I'm old enough to have been involved with it when it was the Federation for Community Planning. I'm not old enough to have been involved with it when it was the Welfare Federation. But I go back a little bit, and I started there as a volunteer. I was actually on the, there was a group called Citizens Mental Health Assembly that was focused on mental health issues, and I was a volunteer on that. There was a group called Healthcare for the Homeless that worked out of the Federation. I was involved with that. So I feel a real deep affinity for the work that the organization does, and I feel very fortunate to be back there. So one of the things I want to talk about today is I'm going to talk a little bit about some of what I think are some of the really important issues that are going on at the state level in terms of the state budget and where and how we might think about approaching them. And I also want to talk about why I think, and this conference I think is an example of that, about why organizing for collective action and advocacy is so important, that we can't do any of this by ourselves, that we've got to work together to address some of these issues. And one of the good things about this conference is it brings a lot of you together from different sort of aspects of social work. Some of you work with kids, some of you work with older adults, some of you work with folks with substance abuse or mental health problems. So you have a lot more in common than you have differences, and so trying to find out where some of those commonalities are, where some of those important issues are important. But it's timely that we're having this conversation today because in probably, I would say, in about maybe 3 weeks, 3 or 4 weeks, the Ohio Legislature, the Ohio House, will vote on a state budget bill. And I think a state budget is probably the single most important policy document that, or a budget is the single most important policy document that a legislative body passes. Because you can tell me all the stuff you believe in, you can give me all the buzzwords and all that kind of stuff, but show me how you spend your money. Show me where you put your money, and that is what you value, and that is what we value. And so the state budget is a really important thing to focus out and care about. And I think you, as social workers, have a lot to contribute to that conversation. Because, as I referenced earlier, in many instances, what you do is where kind of the rubber hits the road. You actually have direct contact with folks who depend on these programs, who depend on these services. I'm sort of up here a little ways away from that. And so I may think something might work really well, and then I talk to one of you and you say, well, that doesn't really work the way they said it's going to work. It's not as easy as that. There's this little thing or that little thing. Or let me tell you about this client or this individual who actually had to sort of work around this program. And I think the other thing that you can do, that you can bring to this conversation, is you can be a voice for your clients. You can be a voice for folks who don't often have a voice in this policy process, and you can make sure that their voice gets lifted up and is heard by policymakers. So I would encourage you to think about that. I also think, from my experience, one of the most effective sort of advocacy strategies, and particularly with legislators, is when we tell a story. Because, you know, I mean, at Community Solutions, we're very good about research and studies and data. We got probably studies as high as this, and data is probably as far as wide as this. But sometimes it's that story that really sort of captivates people. And I'll put myself first in the situation of being the kind of the person being lobbied, because as Julian referenced earlier, I got to serve as state Medicaid director for 2 years. And let me tell you, that was an experience. But it was a good experience. And I remember when I first got there talking to Dr. Mary Applegate, who's the medical director for Medicaid. She said, "Well, John, what do you want to get done while you're here?" And I said, "Well, I'm here to implement the governor's agenda, which was to expand coverage and to get more people covered on the Medicaid program." I said, I also want to learn from this so that when I leave, because I knew I wasn't going to do it forever, that I want to be a better advocate. And she said something to me that really just resonated with me, and I hadn't really thought about it before. She said, "Well, you got the best job for an advocate right here. You're inside. You can affect change inside." And I was like, I had sort of turned off my advocacy switch when I went into state government, and then I turned it back on. And through that process, there were things I could remember still sitting in a conversation with some of my staff. There was a time in Medicaid when we required people who were age blind disabled to come in every 6 months to read a term. Now, it wasn't like they weren't still blind or disabled that next 6 months. But we still did it. I said, "Well, why do we do that? Let's change that." And so we did. And we kind of snuck that through a little bit because, sometimes, I don't know, those of you who work in government, there's usually this place called the budget office. And so you're doing stuff over here, and someone's sitting over in that budget office like, "Is that going to cost more money?" So we had to sort of show, well, it didn't really cost more money because all the money we were spending redetermining people all the time, and all the time they were churning through these programs, was money that was wasted. And so we kind of figured out an advocacy strategy inside to sort of do that forward. And for me then, the personal story experience that I had as Medicaid director was, one of the things that Governor Strickland tried to do was expand CHIP eligibility up to 300% of the federal poverty level. We were at 200, we wanted to go to 300. And at the time, this was when the Bush administration was still in office, they were saying, "No, you can't do that," and actually blocked us from doing it. And we sued them. We sued the federal government over that. And so eventually, administrations changed, and we were going to start moving ahead with it. At that point, though, we were almost out of money. That was the time when the recession hit, and our Medicaid caseload was growing 20 or 30,000 people a month, and the economy was in a deep dive, and our resources were slim. And so we talked about it. I was like, "Well, maybe we can't afford to do this now." And so I was like, "Okay, I guess I can accept that, that we don't have the resource to do that." And then I remember I was at home, I think over that weekend, and I woke up in the middle, and I had this dream actually about this mother I had met and her kid who would have been covered by this new expansion. And I sort of woke up the next day, I went into the office and said, "We got to put this back in." And so we worked on that, and we got agreement to kind of put it back in, and obviously then other things happened in terms of coverage expansions that took care of that, but I think those personal stories that you share when you're a policymaker, they make a difference, and they make a difference to us individually. And I want to tell you about one that I heard, that I read about, that has just kind of stuck with me. And this was about. And I read this in a newspaper when I was doing researching an issue, and it was about an elderly woman who lived in Stark County, and this woman was infirmed and had to use a walker, but her house was so small that she couldn't use the walker to kind of get around that house. She couldn't maneuver within her house, and so she had an adult daughter who would check on her daily, make sure her mother had some food. But because her mother was unable to couldn't use this walker, she couldn't reach the table. So she ate her food off the floor, in a plate or a bowl on the floor. That's where she got her food. And because she couldn't use that walker to get into the bathroom, her daughter would leave her with two diapers to wear during the day. That was the way that she sort of took care of her. And when I tell that story, it just like I have a hard time not just I think of my two parents, my 85 and 85-year-old mother who is still alive, God bless them, I was like, how does somebody do that? How does somebody put somebody in a situation like that? You probably, some of you who are in some of the related fields probably have stories that might even be worse than that, you know, situations that you've come across. But, you know, the woman lost 20 pounds, but then Adult Protective Services got involved. You know, they learned about it, went to probate court, found her a safe place to live. She lived probably for a couple years after that, but at least lived in a much more dignified, safe way. But it just, so when I tell that story, one of the reasons I tell that story is because this is an issue in the state budget. And I don't know if Georgia Annitzberger's here yet today, but I know she's doing a session here later today on Adult Protective Services. This has been an issue that she's cared about, I think, most of her adult life, has worked really tirelessly on it. The Council on Older Persons, which is part of the Center for Community Solutions, has been talking about this issue since the 70s. But the governor's budget proposes spending $3.5 million a year for Adult Protective Services. Now, that's not a lot of money. I think it should probably be 10 times that amount. But it is the most money that anybody has proposed for that line item in, like, forever. And it comes on top of $10 million in the last year. So when you think about, you know, so that would be a, you know, if you're going to talk to a legislator, those are the kind of stories sometimes you want to tell because they capture our attention immediately. So I want to put a few issues on your collective agenda for you to think about and to think about how they might affect you or the people that you work with. So I want to start first with, I think, one of the most important things that we've gotten accomplished in this state since I've been involved in doing that, and that was expanding Medicaid. We have over 500,000 Ohioans who are now signed up for this program. Over 500,000. These are, you know, and coming from my recent experience at MetroHealth, I got to meet some of these folks. I mean, we met at MetroHealth, a woman who, she and her husband had lost their job. He had become seriously ill, had no health care coverage. She actually sold her wedding ring to help pay for her health care expenses. I mean, you meet real people who are in horrible situations, very difficult situations. So the good thing in the budget is that is still there. The governor proposed funding it at the level that it needs to be funded to continue. You know, and I want to say, give a shout out to us here in Cuyahoga County. Among the urban counties, we have the highest percentage of eligible people signed up. We've done the best job of getting eligible people signed up for this program. So I want to give a shout out, particularly folks who work in Job and Family Services, because they have a tough job in terms of getting people signed onto these programs. I hear a little... Because do people know they have to work out of two computer systems at the same time? They're working out of CRISI and OEIS at the same time. Talk about policy that doesn't sometimes match up with practice into reality. But I want to talk about some other things, too, that I think you should care about. One of the things I'm really worried about, here's a bad thing in the budget that I'm kind of worried about, and that is the imposition of premiums on people between 100 and 138% of poverty on Medicaid. Everything we know tells us that those things serve as barriers to people. It serves as barriers to people getting signed up for coverage. It serves as barriers for folks coming in to get healthcare coverage. They just end up in the emergency department instead. So, you know, that's an issue that there's going to be some work around that we're going to focus on at Community Solutions, because, you know, the legislature has to pass it, but the federal government has to approve it. So we're going to talk to both sides of that equation about that issue, because I just think it's a bad idea. It's a bad idea. And, you know, and here's again where, you know, this idea floats out there that it's good to have people be responsible, but we don't even have a system to collect the money. It'll cost us more to collect that $20 a quarter than we will bring in. And the other thing about this is, because the federal government is paying almost 100% of the cost of this coverage, we have to give the money to them probably. So we're gonna spend more to collect it, people will get knocked off their coverage, and then we have to send a check to the federal government for whatever we've collected. It doesn't make much sense. Another issue is ending Medicaid eligibility for pregnant women, for people who need family planning, and women with breast and cervical cancer who have incomes above 138. Today, we cover those women up to 200% of the federal poverty level. They're gonna roll that back. And so one of the issues that we focused on was around pregnant women. They said, well, they can go to the exchange. Well, that's only if they get pregnant, I think, between November and February. So, but we won't have that family planning, so we might not be able to ensure that they get pregnant between those months. I think the state has heard us, and I think they're going to fall back on that one. But, you know, if we care about infant mortality, about making sure babies are born healthy, we want to make sure that pregnant women get access to medical care almost before they get pregnant, and not have these sort of barriers in place. So, and is it just me, or is it kind of weird that the three that were sort of taken off are mostly all women? I was like, is that women first? You know, ladies first? So keep that one on your radar. Another one that I'm kind of worried about is the state's proposing to move children in foster care into Medicaid managed care. And it's not necessarily a bad idea, but it's one we got to be real careful about, because these are kids. In Medicaid we talk about dual eligibles, you know, the folks who are on Medicaid and Medicare. I think kids in foster care, could we call them quintuple eligible? I mean, they're in Medicaid. They're probably they're in child welfare. Their families might be getting TANF. They might be getting food stamps. They might have services through their school system. They might have things through juvenile court. They're in all these systems, and managed care has not always been really good at sort of negotiating through all that. And so I think we want to be really careful about that, and I think go really slow into that. And then along those lines is we're also, you know, one of the things when Ohio put Medicaid managed care in place, they carved behavioral health, mental health services out of that. Well, now we're going to integrate it, but we're going to carve it back in. And I worry about that too, because, you know, those of you who work in the mental health field or the substance abuse field, you know how difficult it is to develop good, trusting relationships with your clients and your patients. And so I worry that that might get interrupted. That because today your agencies, you know, you bill or you work directly with a Medicaid agency, in the future you'll bill or work with potentially five different Medicaid managed care companies. And that just makes me nervous. Because again, thinking about how policy translates into practice, one of the things I heard when I was Medicaid director that was a big complaint was I got five managed care companies I have to deal with. They all have different formularies. They all have different prior authorization rules. They all have different forms. I spend all my time filling out forms trying to figure out what's covered, what's not. So actually, one of the things I did was I took that away from the managed care companies and gave it back to fee-for-service. That's been undone. But that's one of the things I kind of worry about, too, on this carve-in or integration. So again, I just think we have to go really slow, make sure that we're not disrupting the relationships between these really vulnerable people and their health care, because I think that's important. There's something to be said for integration, because it's not that... I mean, one of the tragedies of people with mental health issues is that they just have so many health issues. And so to the extent that we can coordinate behavioral health and the physical health issues together, I think is better. Now, there's been a lot of focus, and appropriate focus in this state on the issue of infant mortality. I mean, we have some of the most dismal infant mortality numbers in the country. This community has some of the most dismal infant mortality numbers in the state. And this is one of the ones I think where Medicaid's trying to get a little bit more involved in it, and it's appropriate, because Medicaid is probably the payer, I would imagine, in Cuyahoga County, probably for, 60% of the births in this county, and probably all of the births to women who are at risk of infant mortality. And so getting them more involved in this conversation and having them take more of a population health viewpoint of this, I think is a good idea. I mean, one of the things that I heard when I was at MetroHealth was that, like, what we did at the hospital and healthcare had about a 20% impact on people's health. Everything else was genetics, where they lived, you know, their sort of personal lifestyle choices and things like that. Stuff that we didn't really, you know, we were great when you came to us. We'd take real good care of you. We could, you know, for the most part, patch you up and send you back out. But we were sending you back out to the same place where some of these issues arose in the first place. And so I think taking more of a population health focus makes a lot of sense. So there's a little blurb in the budget around what they call developing enhanced services or case management or community-based services for pregnant women in high-risk neighborhoods. And so I think that's one where I hope, you know, those of you in the social work field will kind of get engaged in that to make sure it gets done the right way, because a lot of you will have more knowledge and more experience and know really what's going on with some of these women and why we're in this situation than I think we might. Another thing I want to put on your radar is, and this has been something that the state has talked about for a long time, and that's merging our disability determination process into one process. You know, today we have Social Security and we have Medicaid. And so people who want to go through the, apply for Medicaid sometimes go through the disability determination process, you know, through the county and state, but other folks go through Social Security. That process can take a long time. And so, one of the things they've done is propose bringing this together and then also eliminating Medicaid spend down. Well, I know everybody hates it. But let me tell you, when we eliminate it, that means there's about 4,500 people who are going to lose their health care coverage because they'll no longer qualify. And so the state's proposed developing a state plan amendment to cover some of those folks, but it won't cover everybody. And so these are people with, because they're, if they get on spend down, it's because they have a lot of medical expenditures and they're people with a lot of medical needs. So I just think we want to be careful about how we go forward with that. And then I think finally what I want to mention is that this budget also includes about 3,000 more waiver slots for persons with disabilities, developmental disabilities, to get onto Medicaid and get community-based services, and that is really important. We put out a report today on Ohio's developmental disability system in the state. We have 45,000 people with developmental disabilities who are waiting for a waiver, waiting. There are people who are living in institutions, in intermediate care facilities or nursing homes who want to get out, who want to live independently. We need to do a better job of making sure they get those services. I'm going to wrap up here. I know that I want to just put a plug in for, I know that we're recognizing Nikki Antonio here today at lunch, and I just want to, you know, add my congratulations. You know, Nikki and I worked together. We both, many years ago, I worked with her when she worked at the Westside Women's Center, when I worked at the Westside Community Mental Health Center, and then we worked together again when we ran the North Coast HIV/AIDS Coalition. She's a great advocate. She's one of the most effective legislators in Columbus. It's really appropriate that you recognize her, and I hope you'll join me at lunchtime in giving her a really big hand. Thank you very much.
Good morning. it's always nice having that greeting. I'm Cleve Gilmore. I'm the dean of the Jack Joseph and Morton Mandel School of Applied Social Sciences at that little school down the road. I want to start this morning by thanking Dean Catherine Lewandowski and Cleveland State University for hosting this event again this year, and what a great turnout we have in this beautiful facilities at the Student Center. So thank you very much, Catherine. My role this morning is a very brief one. It's to introduce my distinguished colleague, Dr. Ana Maria Santiago. She is the Leona Beavis and Marguerite Haynum Professor of Community Development at the Mandel School. And she is the first holder of this chair. And I want you to know that this chair was created by Leona Beavis and Marguerite Haynum, who were social workers in this community for multiple decades, and Leona Beavis was the leader of John's organization back when it was the Welfare Federation for many decades and has brought about change. So they made this wonderful gift to the university to ensure that we would always bring in a stellar scholar and practitioner into the community, and we certainly have done that with Dr. Santiago. Since we're in an educational institution, I want to lead off by telling you that she is a superb teacher, and you can look forward to a great presentation. And as someone who reads her teaching evaluations, I'll tell you, she does challenge her students, so get ready. She's gonna ask something of you, but in return, she gets great reviews from her students, and she's described as a caring teacher. She's also a prolific scholar. In the past year alone, she has over 10 publications that have appeared. It's amazing. She's currently the senior editor of the Journal of Community Practice and serves on the editorial board of Housing Studies. She's recognized as a national leader in community development. She's the immediate past president of the Society for the Study of Social Problems, and she led that society in adopting a theme for its conference, which was held in San Francisco last August. And that theme focused on Lyndon Johnson's War on Poverty, which was initiated in 1964, just over 50 years ago. The conference theme was 50 years later, from a war on poverty to a war on the poor. She delivered a moving and very impactful multimedia presentation on that theme. And I think you're going to hear some of that today in her presentation, so I won't give anything away. The true measure of a scholar is in the impact of their work. Dr. Santiago's scholarship addresses fundamental social welfare issues and informs policy. As importantly, she uses her talents to benefit the community in which she lives. Most recently, for example, she's worked in the Cleveland Latino community to address community rebuilding in the Seymour Avenue neighborhood after the terrible problems which they had in that neighborhood. She is a fully engaged person. The title of Dr. Santiago's presentation this morning is Responding to the War on Poor Children and Their Families, the Continuing Role of Social Work. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Santiago to the podium.
Thank you, Dean Gilmore, for your kind words, and thank you to the committee, the program organizers for inviting me here. And I was told to keep on a fairly strict timeline, so I am going to adhere to that. As a social work scholar, educator, and practitioner, the theme of today's conference is Social Work Addressing Human Needs struck a chord with me. On the one hand, social work professionals could respond affirmatively. Much of the work we do does really address the immediate basic human needs of our clients. However, if we reframe the question and ask, is social work effectively addressing human needs? My response would be more ambivalent. In the past several decades, we have seen significant erosion in both our ability and collective will as a profession to effectively change the structural conditions underlying some of the most entrenched social problems in our society. In this photo essay, I will use the example of poverty, specifically child poverty, to trace this erosion and examine some of the reasons behind it, as well as our responses to the growing political stalemate in addressing the needs of our most economically vulnerable members of society. As I begin my talk, I would like to acknowledge all of the individual photographers and organizations for the photographs included in the photo essay. When President Lyndon Johnson declared an unconditional war on poverty in 1964, he led a bipartisan effort that resulted in the passage of more than 200 pieces of legislation and the largest expansion of social safety net programs in U.S. history. Social workers were on the front lines of this war as advocates and co-creators of these new initiatives to address the needs of our most vulnerable citizens. As a profession, we also benefited mightily from these initiatives. However, these war on poverty initiatives produced mixed results. Noted successes included improvements in the health and economic well-being of elderly Americans, the long-term gains in educational attainment, employment and earnings associated with early childhood education, and the desegregation of institutions and organizations receiving federal funding. Today, critics from all sides of the political spectrum argue that poverty won, with nearly 45 million Americans, approximately 15% of the population, still living in poverty. A decade after being declared the poorest large city in the United States, Cleveland's poverty rate is 38%. Remarkably higher than 10 years ago and second only to Detroit. Critics like Wisconsin Congressman Paul Ryan argue that the war on poverty policies and programs created a welfare hammock and a culture of dependency that maintained current high levels of poverty, a belief that is all too often shared by social work providers. Proponents have argued that poverty rates would be significantly higher today had we not had the safety net in place at all. Rising poverty rates have been fueled by skill-biased technological changes, the globalization of economies and labor markets, declines in unionization, continued erosion of the U.S. minimum wage, declining progressivity of the federal income tax, and the explosion of executive salaries and the size of the financial sector. Who constitutes the poor has been changing as well. While the number of elderly poor continues to decline, poverty rates have increased sharply for working-age adults, particularly former middle-class workers, due to these changes in global, national, and regional economies and labor markets. In the aftermath of the Great Recession, the new poor encompassed the college-educated, suburbanites, and homeowners. Today, more than half of Americans have someone in their immediate family who is poor. Child poverty rates in the United States have climbed to levels seen 30 years ago and are second highest among the most affluent countries of the world. Today, 23% of children in the U.S. live in poverty. That figure is 54% in Cleveland. There are considerable racial and ethnic differences in children's exposure to poverty. Nearly 4 in 10 African American and 1 in 3 Latino children are growing up in economically disadvantaged households. The corresponding constraints this places on child healthy development is jeopardizing not only their short and long-term well-being, but the future preparedness of our workforce and our national well-being. Markedly different from the beginnings of the war on poverty are the political and social contexts shaping our current approaches to addressing poverty in America. As Martin Luther King Jr. asked more than 45 years ago, do we currently have the political and social will to end poverty? Today, I would suggest that the answer is an emphatic no. And I don't know what happened to our screen here. Okay. Not good. Don't know what happened. I am going to continue here. Alrighty. Poverty is rarely mentioned as both political parties direct the rhetoric toward middle-class America. Further, as Ohio Congresswoman Marsha Fudge recently noted, the congressional record on poverty is missing in action. It is this lack of political will that has resulted in poverty becoming a politically toxic issue in 21st century America, receding back into relative obscurity. Unfortunately, our advocacy efforts in this arena also have receded into the background. We have moved from waging an unconditional war on poverty to an unconditional war on poor children and their families. Since the 1970s, there has been a consistent bipartisan gnawing away at anti-poverty programs that has decimated the social safety net for millions of poor American families and their children. Today, this safety net is being further shredded by a struggling economy and labor market, the inability of existing institutions to meet the increasing demand for social services, and political gamesmanship targeting anti-poverty programs and scapegoating poor families. Despite ongoing rhetoric that suggests that we don't yet know how to eradicate poverty, a growing number of scholars, practitioners, policy analysts, and the poor themselves insist that this is a myth. As David Grusky convincingly argues, we already know what causes poverty: a poorly performing economy and a poorly performing labor market. If we believe that these are the causes, then viable remedies include repairing the economy and the labor market through programs that foster job creation, workforce development, and social entrepreneurship. It means developing policies such as the earned income tax credit, increasing the minimum wage, supporting subsidized jobs of last resort for those disconnected from work and welfare as mechanisms to lift people out of poverty. Unfortunately, we are currently living in a political and social milieu that in the aggregate lacks the will to support these types of social action, despite evidence that suggests these initiatives work. The United States has been waging war against the poor people for much of its history. While this war has used a variety of weapons, all are aimed at withholding opportunities for the poor to acquire decent jobs, schooling, housing, and the necessities required for a very modest version of the American way of life. The weapons of choice include decreasing and threatening to eliminate welfare benefits to poor mothers unable to work or find jobs, increasing the punitive conditions under which assistance is provided, and stirring up contempt of the poor among those who are most fortunate. Additional weapons include burgeoning incarceration rates and zero tolerance policies towards the poor, particularly poor people of color. Unfortunately, social work professionals have been complicit in using this weaponry. During the past 30 years, these tactics have escalated with increased visibility of the poor and the problems that have been attributed to them. As we have seen during the past 7 years, more well-paying and secure jobs disappear from the American economy, many Americans will not find new ones. And an ever larger number of such workers or their children slide slowly but surely into poverty themselves. A significant part of the ongoing war against the poor is a war of pejorative words or labels generated by journalists and social scientists, which in turn have been used to stereotype, stigmatize, and condemn large segments of the poor as undeserving. These stereotypes continue to bolster public opinion about the ongoing problem of poverty in America. Even in the midst of the economic woes of the past 7 years, we continue to blame the poor not only for their own circumstances, but for the ills of the larger American economy and society. If people weren't lazy, they wouldn't be without jobs. If young women wouldn't be sexually active, they would not be having babies outside of marriage and become dependent on welfare. If people didn't drink or use drugs, they wouldn't be homeless. Who is deemed deserving or undeserving has become increasingly racialized. In a recent experiment in identifying who deserves social welfare support, DeSanti found that even when work effort or lack thereof was perceived as equal, whites were found to be more deserving than blacks. He contends that proposed sanctions against the poor were more a function of penalizing folks based on race rather than undeservingness. This war on words on the poor is a war that kills poor people's spirit and morale and otherwise adds to the miseries resulting from a sheer lack of money. This rhetorical battle has taken away their humanity and rendered them invisible. How often do we pretend the poor don't even exist? How easy is it for us to ignore those whom we consider as undeserving of our assistance, let alone our attention? The war on poverty became a war on poor children when we decided that it was and is acceptable for millions of children in the United States to live in conditions of deprivation to which we would not expose our pets, let alone our own children and grandchildren. It became a war when we stripped poor children of their self-worth, identity, and dignity by labeling them and their parents as unworthy. It became a war when we tied their health and well-being, opportunities and life chances to the zip codes where they reside. Poor children today are growing up in communities where they see widespread abandonment and decay, are more likely to be exposed to environmental toxins, witness or experience violent behavior and gang activity, are more likely to be incarcerated, have limited access to fresh produce and healthy foods, have fewer supports and services, attend inferior schools, and have few, if any, safe places to play. As a result, poor children, particularly children of color, are less likely to meet developmental milestones and face numerous barriers to opportunities. Living in places where few opportunities have been linked to the intergenerational perpetuation of residence in disadvantaged neighborhoods and the diminished likelihood of escaping poverty. Numerous studies document how the deleterious effects of living in neighborhoods characterized by concentrated disadvantage, especially exposure to violence, limits children's health and well-being, and constrains access to the institutions and resources that make prosperity possible. Children living in families that experience deep poverty, who are poor during early childhood, or experience long spells of poverty throughout childhood, are more likely to have lower levels of academic achievement, drop out of school, have poor employment outcomes, and experience more health, behavioral, and emotional problems. Growing evidence suggests that these problems persist into adulthood. Holzer and colleagues estimated that the annual cost of childhood poverty is about $500 billion, a product of foregone earnings, increased costs of crime, higher health care expenditures, and lower health status. Childhood poverty has negative consequences for the larger society as well. High childhood poverty rates deplete the U.S. economy through reduced productivity and output. Duncan and Murnane stress that the United States is not producing the workers we need in sufficient quantities, which affects not only our short and long-term ability to compete internationally, it also diminishes our capacity to address the needs of an aging population. They argue that the United States needs to do a better job of ensuring that more poor children first grow up, complete college or an equivalent type of specialized training, and enter the workforce with competitive skills. This will increase the nation's economic output, increase consumer demand, and lessen dependency. All of our children, affluent and poor, are our most indispensable asset for the future. As our population continues to change, equitable opportunities for all children to participate in and contribute to the nation's economy are not merely a matter of social justice. Rather, they are economic necessities. Our future prosperity, global competitiveness, and community vitality are inextricably linked to our children's ability to succeed. In order to secure that future, investments must be made to provide all children with access to opportunities that enable them to realize their full potential. Such an investment in our children's future can be pursued on moral grounds as well. Why should poor children be penalized for the actions or inaction of their parents? Moreover, given our ongoing sluggish economy, why should poor adults be penalized for the failure of our economic institutions? Poor people and their allies, which include social workers, are not passive observers of this war and the ongoing political impasse. Increasingly, they are fighting back to reclaim control of their lives and communities. This impasse has led poor people and their allies to challenge the political status quo, question spending priorities, reclaim dignity, and to develop alternative and often parallel strategies for fighting poverty and promoting structural change. For the past 20 years, I have been working with hundreds of low-income families to identify with them what works best to promote economic security. It is fallacious for us to assume that those who are more affluent or those among us who are social work providers are the only ones who know how to help poor people prosper. If we move beyond our short-sighted perceptions of poor people as needy and undeserving, we will uncover different narratives that reveal resourcefulness, capability, and initiative. Underlying innovative approaches to poverty elimination is the understanding that ordinary families in low-income neighborhoods have the capacity and drive to move themselves and their communities out of poverty. One such innovation, the Family Independence Initiative in San Francisco, has developed its programming around the idea that what families most need to lift themselves out of poverty is a sense of control over their daily lives, an awareness of the options available to them, and a diverse and active social network that provides support and expands those options. While this recognition does not exempt our communal responsibility towards the most vulnerable members of our society, it underscores the importance of inclusive problem solving and service delivery. One of the lessons learned from the Great Recession is the need to connect vulnerable groups to employment and economic activities, as well as ensure that new jobs are ones that offer family-supporting wages, benefits, and opportunities for growth. There also is an urgent need to expand access to jobs and career pathways for poor children and their parents. Job development in high-opportunity industries like green jobs and information technology are the kinds of high-quality, knowledge-based jobs that offer opportunities for economic security. Programs like Towards Employment and Roots of Success have developed training curricula to respond to these emerging jobs. Also essential to fostering economic security is the expansion of entrepreneurship opportunities. These may include learning the requisite technical and management skills to open one's own business, or they may entail developing employee-owned workers' cooperatives, such as the Evergreen Cooperatives, which is doing sustainable earning farming here in Cleveland, or they may be the establishment of social purpose businesses like Edwin's Restaurant in Shaker Square that provide job readiness, skills training, and employment for some of the most difficult to employ poor people, former substance abusers, ex-offenders, and the homeless. The long-term economic security of poor children rests on their ability to acquire wealth, starting in childhood. Recent innovations include individual development accounts for children, which are aimed at accruing savings over the course of childhood to facilitate their ability later on to attend college, purchase a home, or start a business. During the fall of 2013, Cleveland began its march into kindergarten college savings accounts for 15,000 public school children. Additionally, a number of communities have implemented place-based scholarship programs like the Kalamazoo Promise, offering low-income children attending public schools the financial resources to attend college. Such programs have served as a catalyst for neighborhood and community development in areas at risk for urban disinvestment and abandonment. Finally, alternative strategies for funding anti-poverty initiatives involve the use of social impact or pay-for-success bonds, which are currently being implemented here in Cleveland. Instead of initially relying on government funding, philanthropic funders provide the financial resources to pay for innovative programs. Government officials, service providers, and program funders then agree upon targeted social outcomes. If the program reaches the agreed targets, then the government reimburses the initial funders for their invested capital. And this, in turn, is reinvested into the program, thereby reducing the risks of taxpayers paying for ineffective programs. By raising the stakes for all parties involved to develop programs at work, these pay-for-success types of initiatives hold great promise as effective and a fiscally prudent responses to our societal obligation to provide services to our most vulnerable citizens. In conclusion, there is an array of anti-poverty strategies that poor people and their allies have employed to counter the lack of a champion like Lyndon Johnson and the less favorable economic and political climate that we currently face. As Martin Luther King Jr. said nearly 50 years ago, we as a nation possess the technical capacity and resources to eliminate poverty if we so desire. So who are our contemporary champions? Who amongst us is willing to work in solidarity with the poor to support their solutions to poverty and foster their prosperity? Who amongst us are willing to be the voices that challenge the stereotypes and victim blaming of the poor and arouse the American conscience to collective action. Who amongst us is willing to speak out against stereotypes and practices that stigmatize and often demonize poor children of color as unworthy of our investment in schools and training facilities, youth after-school and summer programming, and other supportive services facilitating their development and helping them move beyond the constraints of their poverty? Who amongst us is willing to challenge the political and social structures that have been and continue to be the root causes of poverty locally, regionally, nationally, and globally? Thank you. I will make available a link. We've just recently recorded a much longer version of this with all of the photos. And so I will make a link available so that can be put on the website so people can have access to that. Thank you.